Okay. Howdy, and thank you for joining us for today's second lecture of the Weeding Out Neutrality lecture series, Pedagogy at the Podium, Social Justice in or Lacking in Library Education. We have our guest panelists today, Dr. Rachel Williams, Dr. Loriene Roy, and Dr. Bharat Mehra. My name is Marisol Moreno, and I'm the Diversity Program Coordinator for the TAMU Libraries and Chair of the Library's Diversity Advancement Committee. I'm joined today by my colleague, Lindsay Rainey, who will be helping with logistics taking place behind the scenes. The DAC is committed to promoting diversity awareness in education, addressing topics that affect both employees and the TAMU community through programs and events. And before we get started, we'd like to begin with a land acknowledgement. We acknowledge that Texas A&M University College Station is situated on the land of multiple Native nations, past and present. These original homelands are the territory of Indigenous peoples who were largely dispossessed and removed. We specifically acknowledge the traditional stewardships of this land by the Tankawa, Tawakoni, Weko, Sana, Wichita, and Kwabitekans peoples. We pledge to support and advocate for the histories, cultures, languages, and territorial rights of historic Indigenous peoples of Texas and the Indigenous peoples that live here now. The statement affirms the continuous Indigenous presence and rights, acknowledges the ongoing effects of settler colonization, and supports Indigenous struggles for political, legal, and cultural sovereignty. If you'd like to learn more information about Indigenous territories and to find out whose land you are on, you can visit native-land.ca or text the name of your city to 907-312-5085. You can also follow hashtag LandBack on all social media platforms to find and support ongoing direct actions for restorative and Indigenous sovereignty. And we'd like to thank the Indigenous Studies Working Group from the Melbourne G. Glasscock Center for Humanities for providing guidance, language, and resources for this acknowledgement. Now on to community expectations. I see that everyone's microphones are off, and please continue to keep them off, at least until we enter the Q&A. Please maintain respect for one another in the chat, and if possible, keep conversations to a minimum so that others can listen to the speakers with minimal distraction. Please submit your questions at any time to me, Marisol. We will start the Q&A with the questions that have been submitted. And today's format is set up to give the moderator and the panelists about 50 minutes. We'll then spend the last 20 minutes in the Q&A. It's my pleasure to introduce our panelists. Dr. Rachel Williams is an assistant professor at Simmons University School of Library and Information Science. Dr. Williams' research examines public librarianship as a profession. Her scholarship gives attention to the ways in which public libraries support patrons and communities in crisis, and how library workers develop healthy boundaries and professional resilience. Dr. Williams' work also explores the connections between social work and librarianship and the ways in which social work service models and skills may inform library practice. Dr. Williams teaches courses about technology, public libraries, crisis management, and evaluation. Dr. Loriene Roy is Anishinaabe, enrolled on the White Earth Reservation in Minnesota, a member of the Minnesota Chippewa tribe. She is a professor in the School of Information at the University of Texas at Austin, where she teaches courses on reference, library instruction and information literacy, and public libraries. She is an adjunct at the University of Hawaii, Manoa, where she teaches a course on Indigenous librarianship. She was the president of the American Indian Library Association and the American Library Association. She serves on boards for a number of projects, including the Library of Congress, Library of Congress Literacy Awards and the National Native American Boarding School Healing Coalition. And Dr. Bharat Mehra is a professor and EBSCO endowed chair in social justice in the School of Library and Information Studies at the University of Alabama. Growing up in India created an awareness and acceptance of human diversity and its multiple forms of expression, thought, and action. His training as an architect in New Delhi in the vernacular track of practice made him visually literate and sensitive towards human factors and design. Surviving domestic violence and child abuse, he represents a voice of resistance to hegemonic forces of patriarchy, chauvinism, and other outdated notions that undermine human dignity and human worth. As a gay person of color, he challenges heterosexism and homophobia, but also confronts ignorance, prejudice, and discrimination prevalent in varied forms in our politically racialized and xenophobic cultural climate. His many research interests include diversity and inclusion advocacy, intercultural communication and action, social justice in library and information science, community engaged scholarship, and critical and cross-cultural studies. Panelists, welcome. Now, I did provide the panelists with several prompt questions, and we will begin with the first one. So for many people, the road to librarianship starts with a library and information science program as a foundation for all their work going forward. It's why we titled our lecture Weeding Out Neutrality, and for two contrasting reasons. The first is to dispel the notion that libraries act as neutral beacons of democracy. Historically, libraries barred information and community access from many members of our society and still do today. The second is to recognize and celebrate those who ferociously work against our legacy, promoting access, resources, and greater visibility to underserved communities. Dr. Williams, we'll start with you. Broadly speaking, could you each, and then Dr. Roy and Dr. Mehra, could you each provide your thoughts on current LIS education programs nationwide? How well do you think their curriculum prepares students for justice-oriented professional practice, if at all?
Thank you so much. That's a great question. And I think it's interesting we're starting with me because I'm sort of the newer person to the profession. So from my perspective, I think that LIS programs nationwide, generally speaking, are in a really interesting position. We're at this interesting juncture where I think that faculty are really, and educators are really interested in more explicitly addressing and incorporating social justice issues than perhaps we have in the past. I think we're also at a point where, you know, maybe we're not incorporating social justice as a framework and conceptually into all aspects of our programs, but, you know, it's something that we're interested in and that we're trying to do. I think we also have to consider LIS programs within the broader context of higher education, which, obviously is an institution that reifies oppressive structures. It's a capitalist institution. And so the work that we're doing in a lot of ways doesn't always align with broader institutional priorities. So I think that's sort of an interesting tension that we're dealing with right now, as well as just the impact of the pandemic, which has unearthed a lot of issues related to equity and access for our students that obviously we need to address. So that's sort of where I see us right now. And I believe that I really like the term ferocious work, because I think that we're at this critical juncture where we really can and need to commit to doing ferocious work as educators. So those are my thoughts at the moment.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. Dr. Roy.
Bonjour, that's hello. Loriene Roy, Indishnakash, Makwa Dodam, Indau, Austin, Texas, Indujiwa. So that's my name, Loriene Roy. I am Bear Clan. I'm greeting you from Austin, Texas. And the whole title of the panel, this weeding idea, my dissertation was on weeding, but it was weeding library collections. So it's like weeding never leaves me. It keeps coming back. But this great question, and I loved hearing Rachel's response. And I see that we have connections that we haven't met before today. So, but broadly speaking, so LIS education, what's going on? It's really hard, I think, to generalize across ALA accredited programs. Those we assume all ALA accredited programs have satisfied the standards, accreditation standards. And in the curriculum standards, there is a statement that says that the program responds to the needs of a diverse and global society, including the needs of underserved groups. So you won't see the word or phrase social justice, but you'll see it implied throughout the standards. To some, programs pay enough attention to social justice, to some too much, to some not enough. It's often seen in faculty appointments. Someone may be known, and an institution may be known by the work of one individual. So we know Tony Somick from Alberta, Nicole Cook, South Carolina, Bharat from Alabama. So, and that's a lot of work to pile on the shoulders of one person. I think that students drive the interest in social justice a lot of cases. For example, here at UT Austin, right during the summer of 2020, that transition summer as we adjusted here at least in our program to going online fully for the first time, starting in spring break and then through the summer into the fall, it was the students who asked for more and demanded more. They actually listed their requests in terms of demands. And our students found out that the university is not allowed to give grants based on the category of race and ethnicity. So what our alums and students did is form a small working group, and they have endowed a scholarship. They're just about there, right? Started raising money, I think in November, and they have almost $40,000 of the $50,000 they need. So they took the action to make sure something changed. Land acknowledgement, the students at UT Austin took the action. We had a land acknowledgement, I wrote it for our school, it wasn't on our website. I requested, didn't show up, but it took the students at UT saying, we demand a land acknowledgement. And so a committee of seven Native faculty, I was with that group, developed one for UT. And then lo and behold, our school put our land acknowledgement on our website along with UT's land acknowledgement. Most programs are versatile. They allow for student interest. I don't know what your requirements are at your programs, Rachel, Bharat, but ours is, we have two core classes out of the 12 that students take. One is beginning, one at the end. They have then room for 10 electives. Within those 10, they can take 6 hours, two classes in individual studies. They can transfer in two classes. They can take four classes across campus. So if someone's interested in the topic, they usually can build their program around it. We have dual degrees. We have graduate portfolios in Native studies, African and African diaspora studies, aging and health, et cetera. And so what happens if something's not required? You know, if we have this versatility and students are allowed to explore, what happens if we don't require something? And I'll close with this little scenario, a story. So I taught one of the core classes that's no longer required. I think it was information and social and cultural constructs. And I asked the students, they're about 13 or 15 in the last time we offered it. So it was a spring class a few years ago. I asked them if they had heard of the person named Emmett Till. Did they know about Emmett Till? One student had heard about Emmett Till. And a student from the South, a Black student from the South, he said, but I didn't hear about it till I was in high school. Didn't hear about Emmett Till in high school. So with the non-requirement, where people are facing gaps in their general knowledge. So history, we had during that summer of 2020, we had a faculty member at UT teach a free class. 2,000 faculty members signed up for it. Teaching Black history to white people became the book. That was the class we took if we wanted to, because there was such a desire to learn. And we need to be able to provide students with those opportunities to fill in what's missing, but also to help them prepare to propel us into where we really need to go. So any program can provide the space for social justice. It may be obvious, it may exist on paper alone, it may exist in the practice, teaching, writing, exist in the work of some faculty, and it may live on in the aspirations and preparations for our students. But we generally have that responsibility and obligation, but it's met in different ways. So that's the long answer to your question. Sorry, Marisol. I'll turn this over to Bharat.
Great, thanks for this two parts to the question. And I'll wear the cynical hat of making us all uncomfortable in sharing some thoughts there. So I do agree that libraries and LIS education have never been neutral. For having the privilege of choosing to be neutral means that you're not neutral. And in fact, you're supporting the status quo, which is not neutral. And so coming to the first question, thoughts on current LIS education programs worldwide, it is stomach-wrenching. And again, I'm warning you that I'm wearing the critical, cynical hat. Now, watching more than past 25 years, the shifting of the positionality of content related to diversity, inclusion, equity, and social justice, advocacy, community engagement in the library and information science professions from the margins over the years now to this privileged commodities of desire within our neoliberal age that we are finding ourselves in. White male, white female administrators, educators, leaders that until recently were so embracing of their white-centeredness and elitism within the professional existence and history, covered in garbs of racism, they're hugging closely their whiteness of privilege, elitism, exclusivity, Anglo-Euro canons, post-positivist paradigms, and such, are now falling all over their feet as in their rush to grab this piece of the diversity cake and jump onto the bandwagon. So it makes me wonder, is it from the frying pan to the fire that we have traversed in the marginality and peripheries of the situated location of the EDIA and social justice content in LIS education to this dysfunctional and unhealthy delusional mode? And so starting with that, moving into the next question, how well is the curriculum performing in helping to destabilize the systemic infrastructures, dismantle white privileges and white oppressions? I will say not at all. And so when I call it this dysfunctional reality, it is the maintaining of the status quo of imbalanced power dynamics that does not change. And white males remain at the topmost of the hierarchical power structures, followed by white women using their whiteness to subjugate, silence, punish, and ridicule others in their blatant and continued positions of authority and control while embracing the verbiage of EDIA and social justice in this neoliberal climate where all of it has become such a commodity. So if you're talking about this pretense of change that is also embracing of the verbiage related to diversity, it is misleading because it presents a mockery and farce while people of color and others continue getting subjugated and marginalized in our efforts, getting ignored, unrecognized, or plagiarized at the least, or not even having the ability to tell our own stories because it has been misappropriated and everybody else wants to jump onto the bandwagon to tell the stories. So I wanted to draw those two aspects to attention. I am an optimistic, hopeful person, but also want to point out some as threads of critique in seeing how we can address and move forward in trying to dismantle, deconstruct the systemic privileged whiteness that we are part of.
Isaac, is, you know, in order to dismantle, we first have to reconcile with the truth. We have to come to grips with this, and from there we can, we can heal.
Yes, can I respond to that? Because I think you're responding, if that's okay, by my colleagues. And so I thought that owning is one thing. Owning, of course, and recently wrote a piece on owning the dysfunctional realities is a step. But having moved to Alabama recently, and again being cynical hat, owning is tells me, when I interviewed, for example, I had the question as a gay person of color, I'm interviewing in Alabama, and that was one of the places that I would always had a fear of being in. And the response was, hey, you're not black, so you won't be treated in a particular way. To me, that reaction at that time itself was pretty dysfunctional. But I say, okay, it's an ownership of being honest in telling the way it is. now, after being here for a while, what it also means is that systems are already entrenched in place and they are not going to shift. That is what the ownership kind of means. And now when I'm seeing the whole neoliberal commodification of these topics in our professional association circles, it kind of reminds me the same thing, that the things are not going to change in dismantling the power structures that are in place. So those are my comments to that, just to spark conversation and take the dialogue further.
Thank you, Dr. Mara. Dr. Roy, Dr. Williams, do you have an additional response?
Yeah, I think Dr. Mara made a lot of really important points. And, you know, just looking at my notes on this question, I agree with you. I think that, you know, these structures are entrenched and that there's a lot of disjointedness between, you know, professional associations, between programs, individual faculty. You know, to me, this sort of feels like more of a trend at a broad level rather than a commitment, which, you know, isn't necessarily new for LIS to, you know, reflect rather than lead or facilitate, you know, dismantling these structures. But that really resonated with me. And also Dr. Roy's comments about students really pushing a lot of the social justice work that's happening in LIS programs, that's very true at Simmons as well. So both of those comments really, really spoke to me.
Yeah, thanks. I'm learning so much from my colleagues on the panel. Thank you. Brad, I wondered how things were going for you in Alabama. I remember when I finally figured out that I was in Texas, was probably about, I moved here on New Year's Day, and I think it was in August that first year. So busy, just trying to get adjusted. And I remember standing in our PCL library, general library on campus, next to the elevator, waiting with some other people. They happened to be men, and the elevator doors opened and no one got on. And I wondered what was wrong with the elevator. And I realized they were waiting for me to get into that elevator. And I wasn't used to that. I said, oh, this must be a Texas thing. And so just the differences that you're aware of in the places that you live. We talk about the distant past sometimes, the what's solidified. But I want to remind people that the past is not distant. One of my colleagues, UT started something called the Distinguished Service Academy and sent out a call for people to be nominated or to not self-nominate, to recognize people who in their work, faculty in their work, who stood for service. And so I was fortunate to be selected to be one of the first five or the inaugural cohort. We call ourselves FIERCE. FIERCE stands for something, but it means we're pretty tough. And one of my FIERCE colleagues yesterday was giving a talk to some retirees. And so these folks, the other FIERCE folks, they're often chatting. You're getting, I think I must have received about 30 texts from them yesterday. And she was giving this talk, and she's very involved with the LGBTQ community. You'll know her in terms of her self-identity. But someone in the audience said, being transgender is chic. And people just do it for the attention now. And so no matter what happens, you always are going to have these, don't want to hear it, but not too surprising statements. And you're kind of reminded that this is not something far away. It's not accomplished. It's not conquered. I'm giving a talk later this week at the Alaska Library Association, a talk that is a revision of something I'm working on. We're heading toward a paper. It's really looking at the history of 10 years ago within the American Library Association. And it's the failure of ALA to pass policy regarding traditional cultural knowledge. And it's looking at the erasure of that whole topic. You won't find it anywhere on the ALA website, for example. So history is not so far in the distant past. And it's something that comes to mind daily, especially if you are a person of color. You're being told, Bharat, that you're fine because you're not Black. You're not gonna have to worry about it. When I used to be physically on campus a lot, and our building was on campus. Now we're a little bit south of the campus, 40 acres, original 40 acres area. But I used to like walking past, especially the Black students, the guys, and they'd give me the nod. I'd loved getting the nod because it was a little recognition that we know your day is not always easy either, is it? And I just want to recognize you. So there are ways that you can kind of band together and be part of this community. And that's, I think that's what we always seek out, that community of commonality, that community where you don't have to start every discussion from scratch, but you are lifted up because, you know, again, you're not alone. Rachel, I'm reminded of the classes that we probably teach to, you know, you teach in public libraries, I do too. And the history of that Boston Public Library and how forever we believe that this was a righteous act, that they stood up for the common person to have a place to continue their education, the crowning glory of the public school system. And then it took till the 70s, mid 70s for someone named Michael Harris to say, look, there were some other motivations among those Boston Brahmin. It was a social control, episode. And that continues to this day. This just didn't happen in the 1850s. It continues. So I'll pass this back to our moderator or to my colleagues to add more.
Thank you. I'll move on to my second question, which is a more focused question into your work. Could each of you speak to your respective focus in library and information science, and how you define and infuse the social justice framework to it? Dr. Mehra, we can start with you.
Great, thank you. Great question. So in this privileged position of an endowed chair focusing on social justice, inclusion, advocacy in LS education embedded in a Southern university in the United States, I found shades of white fragility in people's responses to my position. And that kind of connects to the whole neoliberalization as a product and a commodity, and people's biased understanding of it, or maybe the reality is that it's all watered down and it's become such a hot topic amongst people to talk about. So I'll give you examples. When I was at one of the library grants that I'm part of, an advisory board, and I introduced myself. And one of the state librarians, a white male person, goes and says, when I introduce my title, hey, I'm the endowed chair of social injustice. Ha 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 ha. As a way of humorizing, making it humorous and making it flimsy, because maybe that's what it has become in the social media circles and such. The term social justice warriors has its own legacy of how it has been misappropriated and having different perceptions around it. So it was interesting. Of course, at that time, I usually don't think so fast on my feet, but my reaction was that, hey, it's because of the whole white male privileged positionality in our professions that maybe this position has been created in response to that. So that kind of, everybody, of course, around the room looked at them really strangely. Hey, what was an odd thing to say for that person? But of course, he recognized, he said, oh, I'm just making a joke. We are great buddies. And we are, of course, going to hang out after the panel was over. So, but just to point out, as I see in response to the question, my quest has now become to speak up and speak out against these hegemonic, outdated notions that we come across. And in some ways, as Dr. Roy said, it takes a lot of energy and inner strength to be able to keep playing that role of speaking up and speaking out. And so I'm so fortunate and blessed that my students, as it was pointed out, are out there recognizing, and my role is then to identify the layers of problematic aspects that are there in our cultural environment and society now, in order for them to be able to take ownership of this role of making us all uncomfortable, and uncomfortable to face the inconvenient truths where white people have been responsible for the reality of where we are because of those positionality or positions of power and all that stuff. And so we are not here to massage white fragile egos. So my three levels of discomfort that I'm going to say this, shove it in the front of people's faces loud and clear, is to let them experience what BIPOC people have experienced for all the centuries and time. So on my front, as working with students in my classes and with my administrators and colleagues, first of all, there is this non-white English that you're hearing. And so I take ownership of my non-white English speaking mechanisms and resistance to the colonial and imperialistic world order. And I point it out up front. The second dimension is this neurodivergent, atypical thinker and communicator that I am. And so pointing it out that this is the reality and this is a different mode of communicating and conversing as what traditional administrators and managers might be used to, linear cause and effect in the mode of communication. And the third aspect of making us all uncomfortable is the content of what I'm delivering. That is in terms of paradigmatic shifts in where the epistemological levels, knowledge, where is it coming from? It is coming from all of us. But of course, only certain types of knowledge have been considered to be privileged according to research and scholarship circles, which is with their own biased understandings, theory, methods, methodology, etc. So this shift of reality that our own stories are worth value and part of the scholarship and research circles that we are part of. So that's kind of the first one. And the second element in response to that question is putting the outside inside the classroom. So building that collaborations with stakeholders, groups, communities, external to our privileged white middle-class spaces or exclusionary settings that we are part of, making the students connect with them and deliver information-related works is then again a way to have the students become, as I mentioned in a recent article, the army of social justice warriors. And we are going to take ownership of it and be able to connect with individual stakeholders in order to address those elements of fairness, equity, and justice, and all the aspects that we think it's related to social justice. So I'm going to keep quiet. Thanks for that question. Looking forward to hearing from my colleagues.
Thank you, Dr. Mara. Dr. Williams?
Unmute there. In terms of my research, like you'd mentioned earlier, I'm really looking at how public libraries and staff support patrons and communities in crisis. So specifically, I've been looking most recently at folks who are dealing with housing insecurity or dealing with mental health or substance use disorders, other personal crises that they may be dealing with, which of course, this kind of research definitely brings up issues of access and equity, particularly for the people who are directly dealing with crises, and also for library workers who are providing services to support those individuals. And, you know, I work collaboratively with a social work faculty member around how we can sort of learn from those experiences to support library workers who are challenged every day to deal with these concerns, but don't always have the support, training, and resources to do that labor. Or, you know, we also look at, you know, divisions of labor with, you know, librarians who have a degree and library staff who are dealing with patrons on the front lines and who don't have the support or resources to equip them to do that work. And then in terms of infusing social justice into that work, you know, part of my work is, you know, that research itself, calling attention to the ways in which we support the development of policies and practices that support library workers' efforts. And it also involves acknowledging that this is difficult labor that forces us to reimagine our professions in a way that does not reproduce systems of exclusion in libraries. So for example, what kinds of policies are we developing around sleeping or around how people use the library? When do we decide to call police regarding an unruly patron? Should we do that? I don't think we should. And so how do we enact systems that help us avoid that situation? So all that sort of ties into my teaching as well, particularly my public libraries courses and my crisis management courses, where we talk about policing in libraries, where we talk about how to develop systems that don't create a structure where people are excluded from the library, for example. And then also just acknowledging my role and my socialization into oppressive structures, as we already kind of touched on, and then being open to conversation, critique, being called out, being willing to make changes. You know, I am a white woman, and oftentimes I'm teaching a class full of white students, and there's a lot to unpack there, right? So, you know, when I'm teaching a class, we talk about what I envision us covering in the course. We go through the learning objectives, we go through the topics, we identify things that are missing so that I'm not just directing everything that is covered. So trying to rebalance the power dynamic in the classroom. If students want to spend time talking about community-centered responses to crises, transformative justice, prison librarianship, those are things that we'll focus on. And so I think ultimately, for me, incorporating a social justice framework into the work that I do is acknowledging that I don't have all the answers. Sometimes I don't have an answer, or maybe my answer just isn't the one that we should be paying attention to, but that maybe we can get to an answer together by openly confronting whatever topic it is. And hopefully it does make us all uncomfortable to have that conversation, because, you know, if we're comfortable, then we're not doing the work. But through those open conversations, maybe we can come to a solution together.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. Dr. Roy?
Well, thanks. Bharat, I want to thank you for speaking up in the face of injustice. Thank you so much. You're an exemplar. And Rachel, we have even more in common. Last week, I went to live webinars recorded by our Texas State Library, hosted it, featuring their social worker who is at the Texas State Library. And I have an article or book chapter coming out. It's called Time is a Ship That Never Casts Anchor, Indigenous Adages in Promoting Cultural Humility. And I co-wrote it with a woman from Aotearoa, from New Zealand, Maori woman who is a social worker. And I had found online a reference to something she had published about Maori adages. And I reached behind me and I have it as, it's a little box of cards. And I contacted her and she said, I got it in the mail faster than mail is delivered in Aotearoa, New Zealand. And they're beautiful cards, 30 of them. They have a Maori saying, and then there's the explanation on the back along with a little notebook. But she is terrific. She at first didn't see the connection. I go, yeah, libraries and social workers, the fields emerged at the same time, you know, our sister profession, and it makes so much sense. But I'll look to this question now, and I'll tell a couple little stories along the way, and especially Bharat's answer and this voice. I had not seen a Maori friend for about 12 years, and we met again in fall 2019. She flew over from the north of Auckland to attend the ATOM, Association Tribal Archives, Libraries, and Museums Conference that was taking place in Temecula, California. And so she arrived and we stayed with a former student of mine. And Finna, my friend from Aotearoa, she was, again, I hadn't seen her for about a dozen years. We were talking, we had a great time. And she looked at me, she said, I don't see you using your mana. She said, you need to use your mana more, mana power. So using your voice and your power. And of course, there's a sense that Native women gain more mana as you get older. And maybe that we care less about what people think, or we're just forgiven for something. So that's, I've been trying to do that since fall 2019, using my mana, but I have to also learn my boundaries. You know, there's not every time where I have to say what I'm thinking is what I've learned. Sometimes it's not so helpful. Sometimes it's just good enough for me to write it down as a note for myself. And so using Ramana. So how do we speak? How do I speak for my focus in LIS, and how do I infuse social justice? So I turn to the voices that make sense to me. And this would be Indigenous peoples. A year ago, March 2021, you know, we attend all this stuff online. My schedule's packed. I'm sure all of yours is packed. Just figuring out the time zones and when to show up and how many things to register for, because hopefully they'll send a link and I can look for it afterwards. But one of the best things I've attended over the last year was a talk by someone I knew was going to be terrific, Linda Tuawai Smith, who wrote the book, and that was published in 99 on decolonizing methodologies. But she spoke just from the cuff, and everything she said was so meaningful to me. I don't think life is worth living as an Indigenous scholar, she said, if you can't imagine a better world. Most Indigenous people are in the context of revitalizing Indigenous knowledge. It's not the responsibility of Indigenous knowledge to save the West, to provide solutions for systemic problems. It has no responsibility. People have the responsibility. The purpose of what we do is for Indigenous people to thrive and flourish and to go about their lives. And so that, to me, is like the best model, the best idea of what to do. I also turn to the writing of another friend of mine, Greg Cahete, who wrote a book called Look to the Mountain. And I always refer to the bottom of page 23, where he writes about what it does mean to have a fulfilled life. And he looks at the orienting energies. You might see these sort of in an information search model, but it starts with being, asking, making, having, sharing, and celebrating. And the most Indigenous of those two actions is being, knowing oneself, knowing one's community, one's culture, which is a lifelong process, and then celebrating, doing something that says, yes, we got through this. The first International Indigenous Librarians Forum took place in Aotearoa on the campus of University of Auckland. And I've been back a number of times. I revisited that site about three years after the forum. And someone was guiding me to the room where I was going to give a talk. And they asked if I'd been there before. I said, oh, yes, I was here for that International Indigenous Librarians Forum. And the person guiding me stopped and looked at me, and they asked, were you here for that? I go, yes, I was here. They go, you know, we've had the historians, we have had the linguists. Nobody's partied like the librarians. And so we were notorious for celebrating this event that took years to plan and to bring about. But Greg Cahete, in addition to these actions or energies, starting with being, ending up with celebrating, talks about the foundation of leading a fulfilled life for an Indigenous person. And that's finding one's true face. That's your character, your potential, your identity, one's true heart, your soul, your creative self, your passion, and then your foundation, true work and vocation. So leading a fulfilled life, and social justice allows one, gives one permission to do this. For my students, we do a lot of service learning, working with Indigenous peoples and community groups. This semester, we're working with Haskell Indian Nations University, one of the tribal colleges, and my students are creating Pathfinders LibGuides, and they're working on some instruction videos. 2 years ago, we worked with the Native American Boarding School Healing Coalition on creating videos for anyone to use their database, how to search. We've worked with the Tribal College Librarians Institute with conferences and gatherings, and traveled some, and when times were in the before times, have traveled to gatherings in many places. So there is a way, and our field is so permeable, it's so flexible, there is a way to bring everything important into it, and to find the community of support that you need day-to-day basis. So I'll pass this back on to my colleagues.
Thank you both. Thank you all. I'm sorry. My next question is, and Dr. Roy, you may have spoken a bit about this, but my next question is, have you seen any positive changes towards the inclusion of social justice framework in library school, either by students incorporating it in student organizational efforts or otherwise? If the focus is absent, where does it seem to be centered on?
Okay, I'll start this off and then look forward to hearing from Rachel and Bharat. So yeah, I've seen change in the last decade. I've been here longer than some of you have been alive. So Indigenous librarianship, we'll talk about that as an example. It's young, it's active, it's strong. and it's being recognized. And there is a whole group of young, active Indigenous librarians, and it's terrific to see them being recognized in national awards for the work they're doing day to day. And there's no longer one person you have to talk to who's kind of everyone assumes speak for the group. No, it's there are a lot of voices. We're seeing this place where we can feel best, where we can feel centered. Here at in our program, we have, of course, a committee. There's a committee on diversity. And for it kind of rotates who's the chair. And I recall a colleague, majority, not global majority, but Anglo, as we say down here, colleague who was chair. And she would tout how much that she had accomplished, the number of miles they drove to different sites, the number of pamphlets she turned out. But I didn't see anyone admitted to our program who said, I came because of this contact. And behind the door, she would say something like, you know what, I gave a talk at this HBCU. And students came up and shook my hand, but not one Black student. You know, so I don't think she got the message that she was not approachable, that there was something about her pushing, you know, herself as the voice of diversity when she wasn't diverse, that didn't ring true. We now have a diversity officer who started just in January. And because all graduate programs at UT are supposed to have a diversity officer. And it was one of the things I said, you know, I cannot leave this place until we do these three things. And one of them is to have a diversity officer. Otherwise, it's relegated to a chair who is temporary, who takes it on and moves on and counts the miles they travel. What's being rewarded, which is always a challenge. If you choose service, you're not necessarily rewarded. Remember that year after I served as president of ALA for my annual review, my dean at that time said, I'm giving everyone a raise this year except you. And I said, why not? And he said, you haven't worked for me this year. You worked for someone else. I said, you know, I had one semester leave from teaching. I said, I gave 150 media interviews. I identified the school at every interview. I made sure students were on appointments. I had a room at the university when ALA was in Philadelphia for its midwinter meeting. 13 students were in my room. And I made sure they became aware of what the profession was all about. I worked for our program. Still didn't get a raise that year, but life goes on. So you have to realize that especially faculty of color who speak up don't always get recognized, and sometimes they're penalized for their voice and for the action they may choose to take. There's lots of room, and for a Native person, you cannot not do it. You cannot walk into a room and not be known for having done something. And so it is a requirement. There's a fear of politics. There's a fear of speaking up and we're always reminded you have to speak as a citizen, not as a faculty member. We see social justice talked about in classes, but not relegated to a separate class, which has its advantages and disadvantages. It should be interwoven into the classes we offer on ethics, to the required classes. It's not in the domain of school libraries or public libraries. It should be something that all students cannot avoid. It can be a part because their voices are strong and they want to contribute. So I hope I've brought a few things up that will ring a bell of warning or delight or an agreement, but I look forward to hearing from my colleagues.
Dr. Williams?
Yeah. So definitely some similarities with us. I do think that there are positive changes, specifically, you know, like we've talked about, our students are incredibly active at Simmons in all of our student organizations, particularly the Progressive Librarians Guild student chapter and our ACES student chapters. And they've developed some, you know, some programming that they've really spearheaded, which has been fabulous. In terms of the course offerings that we have, we have developed a few courses specifically around social justice in LIS. So all three of them were developed collaboratively. So the first one, which I was not involved in developing, is intersectionality in the information professions, where, you know, we're looking at race, gender, intersecting social identities, such as sexuality, social class, and ability, impact and are impacted by people's interactions with information technology and the information profession. So a few of my colleagues developed that one. And then as part of the work that we did on the Equity, Justice, and Culture Committee, so we have a similar committee, sounds like to your committee, Dr. Roy, we developed a course on decentering whiteness in library and information science. So really looking at developing a deeper understanding of key ideas and concepts from whiteness studies, critical race theory, and other theoretical frameworks in order to develop more critical analysis of the history of whiteness in libraries and other information environments. And then the crisis management and rapid response in libraries course, where we look at responding to disasters and crises and critically examine case studies, explore resources, infrastructure issues, and the impact of crises on communities. So, you know, just yesterday in my crisis management class, we had a discussion about library responses to civil unrest. And, you know, some of that conversation was positive regarding the ways in which libraries have responded to protests and and rallies and things like that. But some of it was critical and asked questions regarding why responses and programming weren't directly confronting racism, but rather attempting to be neutral, which, as we know, really is supporting the status quo. And in some cases, it's just outwardly racist, depending on how the library responds. So the conversation raised other questions about community partnerships, such as the police, the problematic relationship that libraries often have with them, and what we can do about it. So students are really engaged in these topics. It is often relegated to those either student organizational efforts or elective courses. So, you know, these are some wonderful changes, but, you know, at least for our program, and sounds like for many other programs, that these are not requirements. So it's possible for students to go through the program and not really have to confront these issues within their education. And so when we're thinking about professional practice, I know you pointed to this, Dr. Roy, but just how do we address these issues within all of our courses and not just in specific areas?
Thank you, Dr. Williams. Dr. Mehra?
Yeah, thanks. I'm appalled about the response of the dean to the situation, Dr. Roy, that you mentioned, and not being able to see that the visibility that you're getting for this college and for the university through being a president of ALA, that it's free impact, that is the fact that the person is kind of use that as a way to punish you or whatever foul control issues are there, is really appalling. And only in this culture, white males can get away with murder. And that's an example of that. Sorry to hear that. The question that was posed here also in the chat, how can I combat neutrality of certain institutions as a current grad student and future librarian? And that addresses that question and my response to it, that many times I've had students and I have myself use the lingo that these institutions of privilege are presenting of themselves in terms of diversity, intercultural, international, social justice, use it as a way to get your agenda across. And at the University of Tennessee, I know when I was on the Faculty Senate and the issue of marriage equality, and that time the law had not been passed. And so we used that information about the intercultural international program as a way to measure where the university stood in terms of 33 different variables, and collected data to then show that based on evidence, and again, the language that you are saying about yourself, LGBTQ is also part of the intercultural element in there. And so here is the evidence to show that, to propose how far we are behind in comparison to other top 25 universities. Again, these policies that were being used by these institutions of power to utilize them as a way against them in the sense of bridging the gap between what is the verbiage and what's the reality, and trying to kind of bring them closer together in calling attention to the lapses and the gaps that they have. And so another strategy that I've passed on to students, which we have really have done remarkable work, is calling attention to the ignorance that is there, the invisibility, the erasures that are there. They're part of our story. And the students are then able to tell their story and confront with evidence in challenging where there might be have been injustices. For example, recently a white male administrator taking great pride in his 46 years of academic library education administrator, when I questioned about preferential treatment and biased decision-making in favor of a white woman faculty from his old institution where she was a student of his, and I called it white daddy syndrome. And I copied the provost on that message telling, and he was telling me, oh, I'm anti-diversity. How can you call me anti-diversity when I'm supporting a white woman in this manner? And calling attention to the aspect of intersectionality and the fact that you don't understand that and you are sending me an email message with this ignorance there. And who is being killed and brutalized by the police? Not the white women, but the men of color. And so throwing that in my face is a shameful act. And calling attention to the shameful acts is what I transmit with my students too, in decentering the privileges. We all have privileges. I have, as a male, I have privileges, but drawing attention to those and then getting the students to acknowledge where they have their own privileges and where they can challenge the oppressions they might have experienced. So many of my, all my courses talk about activism and advocacy. All the topics of information related work have potential to make an impact. It's about how we have conceptualized that or not, the blinders that we have. Second one, this whole notion of best practices versus promising practices. Best practices, ALA, PLA type of groupings. Oh, everybody is homogeneous and you're all same. Let's do a standardized model that is applicable to everybody. And I've always questioned that and pointed to the attention that we are not equal. We have to recognize the equitable political, social, cultural, economic realities that we might have experienced in order to identify that we are not equal. And let's not pretend in this garb of democracy that many of our professional institutions and stuff adopt in wiping clean as if the slate is clean and is same. It's not. The other aspects are asset-based framework. We bring unique capabilities and capacities because of our equitable experiences. And so let us recognize those and be able to work together in not a deficit model. Oh yeah, what is less? Information need. Or the person is needy and helpless as if they can't do anything on their own. Where do you recognize what positive realities of everything else that they bring to the table? And so we need to be shifting our lens of vocabularies and analysis and services and programs and everything else that we have created in an egocentric profession within a white-centered academy. And so that's kind of my closing thought in pushing us to take the conversations further in our own workplaces, in our own institutions, in our own educational settings, to push the envelope there. Thanks for listening. It was great listening to and with the panelists.
Go ahead.
You bring to mind something I just read. I was a reviewer for a dissertation that someone wrote outside the US. And the writer said something about the phrase, I didn't learn that in school. She was writing about white fragility and how she often would hear, oh, it's not my fault, they didn't teach me this, I didn't learn this in school. And how she brought that back to the person who was mentioning that. She said, they are returning the conversation back to themselves once again. It's about me. I didn't learn that. I wasn't taught that. And I thought that totally explains why I can't stand hearing that. It's not my fault. They didn't teach me in school. Well, then learn it is probably my response. Okay, I'm done ranting there.
I think that's what, it's interesting because I think that's what we, you know, many of us are trying to do is how do we take, you know, these desires to take action and how do we move forward with changes that we want to see and be courageous to do it. And I think a lot of that is, you know, having to use a social justice framework, critical race theory framework, to help us move the move our, you know, what we want to see into reality. I know we're now entered into the Q&A portion of the, I know we had one other question, but I'd like to offer an opportunity for members of our audience to ask questions to our panelists. So feel free to enter your question in the chat, or if you'd like to unmute and ask your question, I believe you can find the hand raise feature at the bottom of your screen. I'm going to go ahead. I know Dr. Mehra, you responded to the question that we see in the chat. How can I combat the neutrality of certain institutions as a current grad student and as a future librarian? Dr. Williams, Dr. Roy, would you like to respond to that?
Yes, I think actually the last question that you had that we didn't have time to get to sort of pointed to that. The question about censoring literature that's pro-LGBTQIA, anti-racist, anti-fascist, and so on. And I think, you know, if we want to combat that neutrality, I think first of all, we have to acknowledge that if you are neutral, you are repeating, supporting, and reflecting oppressive institutions. You're not countering anything. That's not a stance. That is a stance for oppression, and that causes harm. So I know that calling attention to that is risky, and it does put you in a vulnerable position, especially, you know, as somebody newer to the profession, it sounds like. But, you know, first of all, we have to call attention to it, and we have to call on ourselves and on other people to be accountable to that. And I think that's sort of the first step in challenging neutrality.
And the question that Dr. Williams was referring to is one that was related to censorship about movements across the country, focusing their efforts in libraries or on libraries with the goal of censoring literature that's pro-LGBTQIA, anti-racist, anti-fascist. Dr. Roy?
Yeah, I'll respond first to the question on combating neutrality and what can a student do. A student can do a lot, as can any individual do a lot, or can choose not to do anything. You know, there's a spectrum. I would say find out what counts. What does that institution value? Would they value you serving on a committee? Would they value you giving a talk? Would they value you writing a grant? For example, listening to my colleagues talk, I say, IMLS grant certification program across LIS programs on social justice. So that we don't have to rely on a person in any one department teaching everything. We can join our strengths together and create this certification program, or however, whatever we want to call it. Maybe go to the ALA APA because they also do certification. So to the student, I would say, find out what counts there. What would they value? What do you do capstone experiences? We give an award every spring to the capstone project that best exemplifies social justice. Would that cause people to pause for a minute? Would that enable your peeps to find you? Find out who shares your interest. And luckily within our profession, it's fairly easy to find those who would be supportive. Our professional organizations all have people who share those values. I'm on, for a lot of my students, Facebook is old hat. For Native people, no, they're there all the time. And so where are the folks that you can communicate with, collaborate with, create that sense of that own structure so that you can create, be that warrior that Bharat asks us to be. And things don't have to be so neutral. And every workplace has this environment. Find the one that sometimes you are kind of stuck with that, but find the place that you can be or the place you can change.
Thank you, Dr. Roy. Dr. Mehra, would you like to add to the question in the chat?
The question is, I mean, the neutrality, I think it resonates what my colleague said, but to the collections and the censorship question, I think, again, thinking outside the box and not in library is the center. Our collections are the center. We have to connect the collections to the impact that they might have on people in the communities. Where is the element of memory and stories? And it's more than just what is contained in the digital collections or in the house, in the institution or the physical building. How do people make a difference in their everyday lives through the use of collections? If we provide children some of the books that are getting banned around the country, they are reading them, asking the children to go home and share with their parents and their families what they read in those materials in order to then make a difference in changing and shifting the mindset of older generation, maybe might be more conservative or might have biases against certain groups and populations. Whereas the younger people are out there and we have to start early. And so I think those kinds of showing the connections between our collection and what difference has it made to something, I think is my is trying to kind of get our professionals to recognize beyond the system-centric ways that we continue to talk about libraries.
I'll add a couple comments too about that last question. Find the folks who can advocate for libraries. For example, LeVar Burton, Reading Rainbow guy, he said, he advised to young readers, read the stuff that's banned. That's where the good stuff is, you know. And there are times where I can't be bothered to try to change someone's opinion. It's not going to happen. But then I think of the young people who are somehow stuck there with those families. You know, they need someone to advocate for them. Getting people to vote. A lot of this is related to the current politics. So can you make sure that all the students in your classes are registered to vote? And I always put on my syllabus, there's a link to the student organization, nonpartisan on campus, that make sure that people get registered. So make sure people get registered and get going to the polls and have a way to get their ballot count. Just when we think the bad times are over, the bad times have come back. So we need to not sit back and just watch it happen in its way. There are, I believe in that sometimes silent majority who do not want these things to happen, like book censorship. And what we have is we have also a power role of people whose books are being censored. And this can lift up and draw attention. I know an author whose book was always on the top, one of the top 10 books that was banned. And he used to call Banned Books Week. I think it was like, what do you call it? It was a money-making deal for him. He said, oh yes, they hear about my books again, once a year, every September during Banned Books Week. So turn it into something that can be positive, but don't relegate that work to someone else, because it might not be picked up, because people get weary. It gets hard joining every battle.
Yes. I appreciate you plugging in, getting folks to register to vote, because we are in election season here in Texas. My next question from the chat is, what do you do in your free or sacred time to ground or refill yourself after days spent thinking, talking, reading, writing, and experiencing the many forms of violence we encounter every day doing this work? Dr. Mehra, we can start with you.
Yeah, well, centering oneself, recognizing one's forces, trying to meditation, trying to get at peace with oneself. There's only certain things, what can one do, what cannot one do. Finding where one's strengths are, strategically looking at what one can change and what one cannot change and where do we need allies? But again, I think finding some time for oneself in taking care of oneself, mental, psychological, emotional health, in then being, that's the only way that one can make a difference. And if one is taking care of oneself, that's kind of in a short nutshell my response to that great question.
Dr. Williams.
Yeah, I agree. That's really important. So I used to play roller derby, but unfortunately with the pandemic, I had to stop doing that. But yes, spending time journaling is really important to me. I also do pottery. So that's very meditative in some ways. You just sort of focus on what's happening on the wheel, and it's really been wonderful for me. But taking that time for yourself, finding small moments of joy, I think is really important, especially as, you know, we've continued on through the pandemic. This is year three of the pandemic, and, you know, finding small moments of joy and savoring those, I think, can be really valuable for finding bits of joy that can help you sort of go back and get back to it. So those are a few things I do.
Roller derby's back here in Austin now.
I know. Not for us. I'm jealous.
So staying in touch with people, I think, is helpful for me, finding out what's going on in their lives. I miss going to live music. So I tend to go to a lot of live streaming. And I mentioned when we were kind of in our green room space that before my classes began, we enter my class hearing music, Austin-based musicians. And also during the break, we feature different artists every week. Learning my language. I think I'm a little more tired this month because there's a month-long class I'm in on Saturdays and Wednesday nights where I can hear my language. And what I like best is the explanation of what's animate and inanimate and how the words go together. And then there's another class in Anishinaabe Mohen starting soon, so it'll be an 8-week. Watching sports on TV, I live stream, you know, I subscribe to a couple of streaming services, and growing things that I can eat. That seems very helpful.
I garden too, yeah.
I initially heard throwing things, so I think that I personally...
That also sounds great though.
So I know we have one more question in the chat, and we're almost at time, and I do want to make sure that I go through a couple of things. If the panelists are willing to stay for the final question. But I just want to thank everyone for joining us and our panelists for their time and their insightful responses to the questions that we provided them, and also from the audience. I'd like to ask everyone to join us again in April for our final lecture of the series, Out of the Stacks and Into the Streets. We'll be joined by a core of librarians to hear about their current activism and how they hope to transform our understanding of libraries and the role they play in destroying unjust and unfair systems. So this is scheduled for Tuesday, April 5th at 1 p.m. And you'll find the link to the registration page in the chat if you haven't registered already. Also in about an hour, you'll receive a survey in your inbox. Please help us by filling out the anonymous survey. Your feedback helps us create a better experience for you and others. And finally, a recording of this event will be uploaded to the library's YouTube page within 48 hours, and we will share it with you when it becomes available. So with that said, I know we're a minute over time, but if anyone from the panel would like to respond to the question in the chat, which reads, what is your vision of a more just, equitable, and anti-racist library education or libraries? What are some ways you would recommend that we push towards the future?
I'll jump in with a quick thought. I think information is power. And I believe having life has provided me all the blessings to be in the position that I'm in, but what it's helped me understand too, that there are people out there, there are individuals out there who are left out from the aspects of information and access to resources, or they are in, they have no control and power over their own lives. And so it's up to us as information providers and librarians to expand our thinking and identify where and who those disenfranchised people might be in order to find ways that we can help support them, whatever those circumstances might be.
Yeah, I agree with that. And just a couple ways in which we might want to push forward or think about pushing forward. I would love to see a future where libraries are funded in a way that supports anti-racism and inclusion. And I would love to see us require social justice education within LAS education. And then, you know, just in terms of how we push forward, obviously, advocacy is always a big piece of that, especially in terms of finding funding and resources, as well as, you know, just looking for those connections like we've talked about. I think finding your people, finding ways to align this really important work with the priorities of institutions so that they're forced to be accountable and to help support this work, I think will help further these efforts.
I love all of those ideas. And ultimately, we want to do what Linda Turaway Smith says. We want to help people thrive and flourish and go about their lives. And we need to have an environment that supports libraries and support that enables them and our students to, again, advocate for those who aren't always included. And you don't have to use your mana, use your power, everybody.
That's a good way to close, use your mana. Thank you all so much. And that concludes our lecture this afternoon. And again, I hope you'll join us for our final lecture in April. So thank you.
Thank you, Marisol. And thanks to our panelists. Wonderful having a conversation with you. Thanks for the insightful questions to all of you as well.
Yeah, thank you all so much. And thank you, Marisol. And Lindsay as well.